Good afternoon. I would like to welcome you to another great talk in our lecture series, United States and World Affairs, the Cold War and Beyond. I'm Klaus Lars, and I'm the Richard Krasno Distinguished Professor of History and International Affairs here at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. And I'm again pleased to report that it is very nice and sunny in Chapel Hill today. I would like to thank the many generous sponsors for supporting this exciting lecture series. If you would like to contribute yourself and become a sponsor yourself, please let me know. All our talks and lectures are available for free on our YouTube channel. Please watch them as often as you can. They all make exciting viewing. And of course, subscribe to our channel. That's totally free of charge. Our talk today deals with one of the major crises of the Cold War era. This was the Cuban Missile Crisis, a crisis which almost led to the outbreak of nuclear war between the United States and the Soviet Union. The whole crisis lasted for 13 days, and during these days, the use of nuclear weapons between East and West was a real possibility. Politicians in the White House went to bed every night not knowing whether or not they would live another day and they would not see another nuclear holocaust the next day. I think we are all aware of the main outlines of the Cuban Missile Crisis. Today we have a speaker who will enlighten us about the details. She will pay particular attention to what Fidel Castro and the Cubans were up to during the Cuban Missile Crisis. I'm very pleased to welcome Dr. Svetlana Savranskaya today to Chapel Hill. And the name is always a problem to pronounce for me, so I ask for your forgiveness. Svetlana is a research fellow at the National Security Archive in Washington, D.C. The National Security Archive is not a government agency, as the name may suggest, but it is a private enterprise based at George Washington University in Washington, D.C. The National Security Archive obtains documents of often secretive foreign policy activities of the American government by means of often freedom of information requests. Its website hosts the bulk of most interesting documents which once were classified top secret, or many of them were, including documents of the Cuban Missile Crisis. At the National Security Archives, Svetlana directs a cooperative project with Russian archives and institutes and edits the Russian and East Bloc archival document series. Dr. Savranskaya earned her PhD in political science and international affairs in 1998 from Emory University, and she also worked as a Hewlett Fellow at the Carter Presidential Center in Atlanta. While completing her PhD, she served as a research associate and interpreter for several National Security Archive projects, including most prominently the Carter-Brezhnev project of Brown University's Watson Institute, as well as the End of the Cold War project. A Russian citizen, Svetlana has won several fellowships and awards, including a prestigious dissertation fellowship from the Institute for World Politics. She is the author of many book and article publications on Soviet policies during the Cold War. Most recently, she has published and co-edited a book entitled The Soviet-Cuban Missile Crisis, Castro, Mikoyan, Kennedy, Khrushchev, and the Missiles of November, and that was published by Stanford University Press in 2012. And also she has published a co-edited book called Masterpieces of History, The Peaceful End of the Cold War in Eastern Europe in 1989. And just told me she's preparing another volume on the summits which led to the end of the Cold War in 1989-90, and that is already a massive volume which will be coming out soon, I hope. Today, Svetlana's talk is entitled Cuba as a Nuclear Power, the Secret Missiles of November 1962. I would like to encourage you to ask lots of questions afterwards. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the great pleasure to present to you Dr. Svetlana Savranskaya.
Thank you very much. I am really happy to be here, and I think you are wonderful hosts, because when Dr. Laris invited me, he said if I had any preferences or requests, and I said it's raining and sleeting and snowing in Washington, could you please arrange nice weather? And I see he went all out, and I am a little concerned that you are heating up the city so much there are some fires around. But thank you so much. This is exactly what I wanted. We miss the spring badly in Washington. We don't even have daffodils. And here, almost paradise. All right, so what I'm going to talk about is the story of the Cuban Missile Crisis that until relatively recently people didn't hear about. And now more and more we're learning about the Soviet side of the missile crisis and about the Cuban side of the missile crisis. I'm going to talk mainly about this guy who doesn't look like your typical Bolshevik, right? Look at that. Is that an image of a Bolshevik that you have? And yet, he is number two in the Soviet state under Khrushchev. And the book was written by his son, Sergo Mikoyan. Sergo Mikoyan was a wonderful scholar. Here's the book. And he worked with us for over 10 years on various conferences dealing with the Cuban Missile Crisis. And he was just this example of really internationalist, unselfish, sharing person who brought a lot of documents from his father's personal archive. He was lecturing, he was talking to people, meeting with people, trying to get the Soviet story out. And at some point when he was really frustrated with the fact that nobody really knows what was going on the Soviet side, he asked us if we could help him write a book for an American reader talking about the Soviet story of the Cuban Missile Crisis. Unfortunately, as he was writing this book and I was helping him edit, he passed away very suddenly and the book remained unfinished. And, you know, it was kind of sitting there for 2 years after that, and I felt it was my debt to him, to his family, to all of us historians, to finish the book and take the documents that he donated to the archive. Again, these are the documents from his father's personal archive that are still classified in Russia. But he donated them. So we translated them, not all of them, but the 50 most interesting ones for the 50th anniversary of the crisis, and they are appended to this book. So what I would like to do, I would like to talk about the story on the Soviet side, a little less so the story on the Cuban side. And I hope that the next frontier in the study of the Cuban Missile Crisis is the Cuban, really Cuban side, because we're still lacking the documents from the Cuban archives. But these documents that we have in the book are Mikoyan's discussions with the Cubans in Cuba in November 1962. So there's a lot of Cuban side in there. So let me just very quickly say what I think and what Sergo Mikoyan thought we learn from this book, or what he was hoping people will learn from this book. First of all, is that the motivation of the Soviet side in putting the missiles in Cuba was very different from what usually it was represented like in the American historiography. Secondly, that Cuba actually was an independent and strong actor, and not just a puppet of the Soviet Union. And that contrary to the belief that existed, and to a large extent still exists in the United States, the Soviet Union could not dictate Cuba what to do. Thirdly, is that the crisis did not end on October 28th, which is the accepted narrative here in the United States. The crisis lasted much longer, but one of the reasons that we never hear usually about that narrative, we think 13 days. This is because most of the studies of the Cuban Missile Crisis were written in the United States. So it's an American-constructed narrative of 13 days and decisive leadership of Kennedy. From the Soviet side and from the Cuban side, it looks a little different. And I will talk specifically about, you know, what is the narrative there. And the last line, I think the more kind of sensational part of my story, is that Cuba almost this close became a nuclear power. It would have become a nuclear power if not for the Cubans' independent, or you could say reckless behavior, that they lost those nuclear weapons that the Soviets were going to to live in Cuba, and that the United States had no idea about. Okay, so let me give you just a little bit of a background. First of all, in terms of narrative. For the United States, the Cuban Missile Crisis starts with the discovery of nuclear missiles in Cuba, and it ends on October 28th with essential concession by Khrushchev promising to withdraw all the missiles from Cuba, all the strategic missiles, the weapons that you consider offensive. And that's the end of the crisis. And during those 13 days, President Kennedy goes eyeball to eyeball with Khrushchev, and the other side blinks. So it's the decisive action by the U.S. president and the reckless behavior of the Soviet premier, who eventually has to step back and take back his weapons. They are short duration, and also very conveniently, it ends before the midterm elections and looks like a complete withdrawal or giving up its positions by the Soviet Union. And the United States is victorious and strong. Now, from the Soviet side, the Cuban Missile Crisis looks very different. For the Soviet Union, the Cuban Missile Crisis really begins with the Bay of Pigs invasion. And it ends in November, late November 1962. Why late November 1962? Because it is in late November 1962 when the last nuclear missiles are taken, warheads, are taken out of Cuba, and the United States gives its pledge of non-invasion of Cuba. For the Soviet Union, the crisis begins so early because from April 1961, the Soviet Union feels committed to the defense of Cuba, which is threatened by what the Soviets believed and the Cubans believed, an impending American aggression. And the Soviets, who signed the Treaty of Friendship with Cuba, who feel that Cuba is a very important ally, the first socialist country or the country that is building socialism in the Western Hemisphere, now they're really afraid to lose Cuba. That would mean a lot in terms of Soviet international reputation. In the communist movement, it means a lot in terms of the ties that were already created at the time, and it means a lot in terms of the Soviet influence in Latin America. And here is where Sergo Mikoyan comes with his interpretation of the reasons for the Cuban Missile Crisis. He shows, on the basis of documents and on the basis of his interviews, that actually the number one reason for the Soviets deciding to put nuclear missiles in Cuba was to protect Cuba. That was number one reason. What does the American narrative tell us is that the Soviets put the missiles there for two reasons. Because of the critical situation in Berlin and because of the overall balance of power, which was easily corrected by putting medium-range missiles in Cuba, which otherwise the Soviet Union could not use against the United States. But if you put medium-range missiles in Cuba, they immediately become strategic missiles because they can reach the United States. And Mikoyan shows in his book how in the discussions in the Politburo, the prevailing reason was to not allow the United States to organize another invasion of Cuba, this time a decisive one, because the Bay of Pigs, of course, was an aborted invasion. The missiles that they put in Cuba were put there from the Soviet point of view as a deterrent. From the Soviet point of view, they were also put there without violating any international norms, because the United States put very similar missiles with very similar characteristics in Turkey. And that was another reason, because it bothered Khrushchev, and especially his military, that the Soviet Union was so vulnerable to an attack from Turkey. They claimed that if you walk along the Black Sea in a really good weather, you can see them. You actually can't. But that was one of the legends, that apparently when Khrushchev was in Bulgaria, he's walking on the beach and his defense minister Malinovsky points across and he says, you can see them and we can't do anything about them. And apparently Khrushchev says, well, let's put a hedgehog in their pants. It's a legend. There's absolutely no documentary or witness support for that. But it describes, that's a metaphor, it describes the deep sense of humiliation that the Soviets felt because those missiles were there and they couldn't do anything about it. So how would the United States feel if the Soviets put the same kind of missiles at the same kind of distance from the U.S. landmass? So then now we go to the Cuban narrative. From the Cuban point of view, which is really, really interesting and so different from the other two narratives. First of all, the Cubans did not fear the United States. And that's amazing. They did not fear the United States because in their revolutionary excitement, inspiration, they believed that if the United States attacked, the entire population would fight and they would not be able to subjugate them unless they eliminated every single citizen of Cuba. So the Cubans count the Cuban Missile Crisis back to the very early events, even before the Bay of Pigs, to usually they would say early 1960 or even late 1959, when the United States introduced embargo and when the relations with the United States broke. Since that moment, the Cubans felt that the United States had aggressive intentions against them, and the crisis is happening regularly for them. They call it October crisis because it's just a month. The crisis can happen any month. There was an April crisis, now it's an October crisis. But one of the really exciting moments, and the moment that we really found out dealing with the Soviet documents, is that the Cubans did not want those missiles. A, they did not request the missiles. B, when the Soviets said, we will bring these missiles and install them in Cuba, the Cubans said, no, we do not need them. A, because we do not fear the United States and we can defend with our own forces. They did ask for conventional weapons supplies. They did. But nuclear, they were against. Because they said, in fact, if you put your nuclear missiles here, it would make us more vulnerable, number one. It will make us a target because the United States will want to take them out. And second, all the Latin American countries will see us just as your puppet, just as a parking lot for nuclear weapons. But the Soviets used a very different argument on the Cubans. They said, okay, well, this is really not about you. Look, you need to take these weapons because by installing these weapons in Cuba, you will help the cause of socialism. You will make the socialist camp stronger. And if the United States ever threatens you, first of all, you have these very powerful nuclear weapons, and then the entire nuclear might of the Soviet Union is behind you. It makes you invulnerable. It took time for the Soviets, took 2 months actually, for the Soviets to persuade the Cubans to take these weapons. And the Cubans' condition, or request, rather, because they couldn't put a condition very easily, they said, we want this to be done publicly because we're not violating any international law. Let's sign a treaty of military assistance, just like the United States has with other countries, and then publicly install the missiles. And then we will be doing a completely legal thing. They did not want to do it in secret, to which the Soviets said, no, we do it the other way around. we will put the missiles there in complete secret. And then, in the fall, in November, it was planned, Khrushchev would announce that these missiles are in Cuba as a fait accompli, and then we will sign the military agreement. The Cubans had to accept that. So, these are the three very different narratives. From the Cuban point of view, the missiles were put there not to protect them, but to strengthen the socialist camp. And while the United States discovered the missiles and began threatening Cuba with invasion, Cubans were willing to sacrifice themselves and their country for the cause of the socialist camp. And then suddenly, without any consultations or even informing the Cubans, over the radio, Khrushchev makes an announcement that the Soviet Union is willing to take the missiles out without any explanation to the Cubans. So the Cubans feel incredible sense of betrayal. So for them, the Cuban Missile Crisis is the story of not only the treacherous and aggressive policy of the United States, it's also about the betrayal of them by their biggest ally. And that wound, that destruction in the U.S., in the Russian-Cuban, Soviet-Cuban relationship really never healed, never healed. Even though Cuba was kind of on the dole of the Soviet Union, there was never full trust after this betrayal of 1962. And the Cubans did not want those weapons to leave Cuba because now, having suffered so much for them, they felt those weapons were Cuba, as the Soviets told them. So now let me go over very quickly what the United States knew at the time and what was actually on the island. And I will try to give you a little bit of idea of the, you know, the idea of why do you put this kind of force in Cuba. So at the time, the United States thought that there were between 8,000 and 10,000 Soviet military on the island, but mainly they were advisors or technicians. And that there were some medium-range missiles, R-12s, but no warheads have reached the island. And the idea of imposing the quarantine was exactly because they believed that the nuclear weapons, the warheads themselves, have not reached the island. You put the quarantine in, and you prevent those most dangerous weapons from reaching the island while you're dealing with what's already on the island. And there were several options. And when we found from the American documents now that are wonderfully available, especially the ex-con tapes, we found that actually Kennedy, President Kennedy, who's always portrayed as this decisive, almost macho leader, was the most dovish member of the ex-con. He was the main dove on the ex-con. And his generals suggested that military action had to be taken against Cuba. Well, there were two kinds of military action. One was aerial strikes that would go over the positions that were discovered by the CIA, and you take them out. The second position was massive invasion of Cuba. And then, in addition to taking out the Soviet contingent, you also achieve the bigger goal, you get rid of Castro's regime. Now, Kennedy was against it. Kennedy chose the kind of a weakest, if you want to define it this way, option. Not the high power fists option, but quarantine. Just preventing further weapons from reaching Cuba. So what was really on the island? What did the Soviets actually bring there? If you talk to the former Soviet military, they are still so proud of that operation. The scale and the success of that operation is unprecedented. It is still studied in all the military textbooks. Now, secretly, from the United States, right under the nose of the CIA, they brought 42,000 Remember I said Americans got 8,000 to 10,000? Well, they actually got 42,000, not just advisors, combat troops to Cuba. They brought 36 R-12 missiles with warheads, with nuclear warheads. They were already in Cuba. They brought 24 R-14 missiles, but the warheads have not reached Cuba for the longer range missiles. And that's just strategic. In addition to that, they brought something else that the Americans were not aware of. They brought 42 Il-28 bombers. The Americans knew Il bombers were there. These were all very slow bombers. They could reach Florida in terms of their range, but they were so old and so slow, they would be shot down within the first 10 miles. In the Soviet Union at the time, they were used in the Soviet Army for target practice, but they gave them to the Cubans. But those bombers were equipped with 6 nuclear bombs, and the Americans didn't know about that. In addition, the Soviets brought the dual-use Luna launchers that are theater weapon that would be used against an invading force. They were very short range, they could not reach Florida, but they would be used if U.S. forces landed on the island. They had 12 warheads, nuclear warheads, and by the orders, by the plan, the commanders would use these nuclear warheads if there was a land invasion of Cuba. So American paratroopers coming onto the beaches would have been met with nuclear fire. And this is how the war would have ended. And in addition to that, and probably the most dangerous and destabilizing weapon, was something called front cruise missiles. And they had nuclear warheads. There were 80 of them. The radius is contested. Some Soviet experts say the radius was 125 miles. Some say it was 100 miles. But no question, they could reach the southern part of Florida. And a couple of these FKRs, nuclear, were targeted at Guantanamo. So if there was a landing of U.S. forces on the island, Guantanamo would be the first target. And how do you think the United States would have to respond? And Kennedy admitted, McNamara admitted, that if any American serviceman was killed by a nuclear fire in Cuba, the president would be under tremendous pressure to respond with nuclear weapons. And where would it go from there? In addition to that, the Soviets also sent, for a very strange reason, 4 diesel submarines, meaning kind of old submarines, which simply could not work in tropical waters, with 1 nuclear torpedo each. And on October 22nd, about the time when Kennedy is making his speech, the submarines are in Sargasso Sea, ready to cross into the area that would be covered by the quarantine line. And the Soviet Presidium is discussing, do we send those submarines to reach Cuba, or do we pull them back a little bit and wait what happens? While they're discussing it, the commanders of those submarines, armed with nuclear torpedoes, have no contact with Moscow, and they don't know what's going on, and if the war started or not, and what are they going to do with their torpedoes? Use it or lose it? So, I will skip over the negotiations part because it's been covered extensively in the existing literature. I will try to kind of concentrate on the new things that we learned. So when Khrushchev and Kennedy actually looked into possibilities of this conflict developing into an all-out nuclear war, both of them stepped back and compromised. Both of them were reckless before the crisis, and they were willing on both sides to reconcile and change their positions and negotiate to resolve this crisis as soon as possible. Except the United States did not want to make it public because they wanted to project the image of powerful, strong, decisive Kennedy. In fact, it was a different Kennedy. It was Kennedy the negotiator. And Khrushchev, who showed so much bravado before, was a very different Khrushchev. He wrote Kennedy a very emotional letter about the ravages of war and what can happen in his experience during the war, and offered to take back his missiles. After Kennedy and Khrushchev decided on the withdrawal of the missiles in exchange for A, public pledge of non-invasion, B, there was a secret deal that the United States will also withdraw the missiles from Turkey. That information was not public in the United States, let alone in the Soviet Union, until the late 1980s. So the crisis is resolved between the United States and the Soviet Union, except the weapons are still there. And now the question is, how do you get them out? And Castro was not consulted, was not informed. How do you explain to Castro that you were doing this all kind of not completely against his will, but under pressure from the Soviet Union to strengthen the socialist camp for the noble goal of building communism everywhere in the world? How do you explain to him that now you just gave them all away under the pressure from the imperialists? That doesn't look very nice, not reputable on the part of the Soviet Union. And Castro is mad. In fact, on the night of October 27th, he sends a letter to Khrushchev in which he suggests, and it's again a matter of interpretation, the Cubans are saying that no, he never actually implied a nuclear strike against the United States, but from reading of that letter, he is expecting the invasion to happen within 24 to 48 hours. And he says in a very delicate way, he says, the person, we have these powerful weapons, and the person who uses them first will have the benefit, will come out a winner, essentially. He says invasion is inevitable. Doesn't say you should use it against the United States, but then he says, and in a decisive move, the camp of imperialism could be destroyed. Khrushchev looks at that letter and he realizes that his ally is actually willing to destroy not just Cuba, but the world with it. And the rhetoric in Cuba at the time is that we are ready to burn and die, burn in the nuclear fire and die to fighting imperialism. And those 42,000 of Soviets in Cuba, who are also not informed at all about the US-Soviet negotiations, they're sitting there, they're expecting nuclear war tomorrow. They're expecting US invasion, and they are all expecting to die. They're very enthusiastic. They're essentially becoming Cuban, because this is the spirit of the time, and they're military. And they have this camaraderie with the Cubans, so they're also expecting to fight on the Cuban side and die in this nuclear war. It's a problem. And Khrushchev knows that the local commanders with those tactical weapons, about which the United States knows nothing, they have capacity to launch them without any codes from Moscow. They can just make a local decision and launch them. So the center sends them a telegram. Under no condition, you're strictly prohibited to use all nuclear weapons. And they list the category, all the categories. So the situation is so dangerous, and the Soviets come to the realization that they can't control their ally. So what do? And you don't want to lose that ally. So they find the only person on the presidium. He was called the Cuban on the Politburo. Anastas Mikoyan, who already had very close relationship with Cuba. He was the first Soviet emissary of the Soviet government who discovered Cuba for the Soviet Union, concluded the first trade agreements between the Soviet Union and Cuba, and had very, very close, basically affectionate relationship with Cuba. And we could talk a little bit about that in the question session. So Khrushchev tells him, you have to go. You are the only person who can negotiate with Castro. So he sends Mikoyan to Cuba. Mikoyan is given three tasks. First of all, negotiate the withdrawal of weapons. He had full authority from Khrushchev to decide on his own any issues regarding the military agreement, meaning which weapons stay, which weapons go, what is the order of withdrawal. Second, persuade Castro to allow inspections of Cuba, because that is the condition, U.S. condition, for giving the pledge of non-invasion. They should be able to inspect. And the third task is to keep Cuba as an ally. The Soviet Union really did not want to lose Cuba. And for sure, even though he is not in a democratic society and cannot be technically impeached, could be kicked out very quickly, which actually happened 2 years later, and one of the charges against him exactly was the Cuban adventure. So he saw that. He wanted to keep Cuba. So they send Mikoyan with these tasks, which is essentially mission impossible. And this is the quote from the letter that Khrushchev writes to him while he's in Cuba. He says, you are the only person who could accomplish this mission impossible. But his negotiating position is very weak because the Soviet Union already made all the concessions to the United States. This trip also takes place in a very difficult personal situation for Mikoyan. His wife is in the hospital, very, very seriously sick. He arrives in Cuba on November 2nd in the evening, and next day his wife dies, and he's informed that his wife dies. And in the evening of the 2nd, he already had a taste of Cuban humiliation and sense of betrayal and the sense of real rebellion against Moscow. So he is given by Khrushchev two choices. You can stay or you can come back to the funeral. And in that letter, Khrushchev tells him, if you decided to stay and resolve the crisis, I will attend the funeral for you. Which he never did, and Mikoyan never forgave him that. He did not go to the funeral. So Mikoyan sends Sergo, his son, back to the funeral and stays in Cuba to resolve the crisis. So the initial solution to the crisis is that he is there listening to all the Cuban grievances. He's actually very sympathetic to the Cubans, and that is why he is seen as acceptable by the Cuban leadership. Castro later said, if Khrushchev came, I would hit him in the face. But Mikoyan, they accepted. And the initial position was, well, we promised the United States that all the offensive weapons would leave. So the offensive weapons only means what? R-12 missiles and R-14 missiles. We pack them up and we will leave. And you will keep everything else. And what's everything else, right? 42,000 troops, Luna dual launchers, 6 nuclear bombs for ill planes, and the front cruise missiles. All of that you will keep. So Mikoyan is negotiating the withdrawal of the strategic missiles. And the negotiations themselves were incredibly difficult, because the Cubans were obviously using him to express their anger for this betrayal. And then, about November 10th, they reach more or less a conciliation on these terms, that Mikoyan said, no more concessions to the imperialists, no more concessions. Cuba will become the strongest military power in Latin America, and he tells them, all most modern weapons that we brought here will stay in Cuba, referring to the tacticals. He says, your armed forces will be the strongest armed forces of any socialist nation, except for the Soviet Union itself, which means the military concentration in Cuba would be more powerful because of the tactical nuclear weapons than the Soviet forces, even in Germany. And the Cubans like that. But then on the 12th, Khrushchev tells him, well, the Americans told us to take out Il-28s, we have to do it. So Mikoyan now has to go back to the Cubans and say, well, yeah, no more concessions to the imperialists, but the Ils will have to go. That provokes the same reaction of betrayal and how can we trust you, right? Castro refuses to see him for several days. Castro orders his anti-aircraft batteries to fire at American low-flying planes, which is another escalation of the crisis. And the Soviets, of course, all this time, they're thinking, oh my God, what if the Americans discover the tactical nuclear weapons there, right? And Cubans just show their more militant side, saying, A, we're not afraid of the United States. We don't need the non-invasion pledge. It doesn't mean anything. They will invade anyway, but now we have all these weapons here, so we will repel them. And they make statements about, you know, like, for example, Che Guevara said, we would, you know, if I had control over those nukes, we would take out New York. Mikoyan realizes that A, you can't control them in any way, and it would be reckless to leave tactical nuclear weapons, any nuclear weapons, in the hands of the Cubans. And he writes a proposal back to Khrushchev saying, we have to take all tactical nuclear weapons back. And Khrushchev approves it, that proposal. So now, Mikoyan has this incredible, and I'm really trying to move very quickly through these events, Mikoyan has this incredible meeting with Castro and the entire Cuban leadership on the night of November 22nd, where he informs them that the tactical nuclear weapons will be taken out. And Castro very reasonably asks him, but didn't you promise us those weapons? Did Americans put pressure on you and you're withdrawing them? Mikoyan says, no, we're actually withdrawing them on our own decision. And Castro says, but why? And Mikoyan makes up something, which is very interesting. He tells Castro something that he knows is not true, but he already wrote Khrushchev about it, so he got Khrushchev's approval. He says, because we have a law that prohibits us from stationing tactical nuclear weapons on transferring tactical nuclear weapons to any of our allies. Just absolutely contrary to what they just, two weeks ago, promised Cubans in writing and orally. And he says, that's the final decision. Castro says again, well, it's a law? Mikoyan says, it's a secret law. And then Castro says, but we can hide them in the caves and they will never find them. Mikoyan says, no, no, we have to take these weapons out. And Castro says, well, if it's the law, when are you going to change that law? And that conversation just shows you an incredible imbalance in power between these two countries. And yet, it shows you that Cubans were not a parking lot, that they were an independent actor who made the Soviet life very, very difficult at the time, could have made it much more difficult. And the Soviets now were in a hurry to take those missiles out. Those that they just 2 weeks ago promised the Cubans, you keep everything, we will train you specialists over time, and you will be the strongest power, second only to the Soviet Union. So I will conclude here by saying, looking at the Soviet story of the Cuban Missile Crisis, we're learning so many new things. We, I think, are learning that the crisis is, every time it's studied, we come to the conclusion that it was more dangerous than we thought. Well, just imagine if the Cubans actually got their hands on those nuclear weapons. We also are learning that the Cuban concerns were very legitimate, very legitimate. And McNamara himself said, if I was a Cuban in November 1962, I would be expecting a U.S. invasion. And if they're expecting a U.S. invasion, it's legitimate to try to defend your country. And if the big brother pressures you to take these weapons and promises you that you can have these weapons in the end, it's kind of legitimate to say, big brother, we actually made a lot of sacrifices to get these weapons. And we told you don't do it secretly. And you told us, no, we do it secretly, inform the United States. And if the United States discovers anything, we will send the entire Baltic fleet. And they sent 4 submarines that all of them broke in the Sargasso Sea because of the temperature. But we also find that it's not the macho, decisive show of force that resolved the Cuban Missile Crisis, but actually concessions and quiet diplomacy in which both sides made major steps back from the crisis. And both of them did not want to admit that they did, because, you know, you want to look like a big, strong guy. So in the Soviet Union, the interpretation was, we moved weapons to Cuba, and they never said neither. I was at Moscow State University in 1983 to 88. Only in 88, it was allowed publicly to say these were actually nuclear missiles. Before that, we moved our troops to show the United States that we can protect Cuba. By the show of force, we forced the United States to give a non-invasion pledge. We achieved our goal, and after that, we brought the troops home. You know the interpretation on the American side. But the real story is much more complicated, and I think it's just a suspense novel. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was very enlightening. First, the Cubans didn't want to have the nuclear weapons, and then they didn't want to give them up. Well, that makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? Can I, before we open it up to questions from the audience, can I ask you just to enlighten us, how much of the story you have just told us, how much did the U.S. realize, and if they had had better or more fuller information, would it really have changed American policymaking in the crisis? What do you think?
I think, respond to the first question more or less authoritatively. In about the second question, let's think about it. It's interesting to speculate. So what the United States knew at the time, the information of the CIA, that the Soviets moved between 8,000 to 10,000 Soviet military, R-12s, but no warheads, and R-14s did not reach the island yet. Now, by the end of October and early November, there were discussions in the United States. Are there any tactical nuclear weapons? Because on the very end of October, the CIA was able to photograph the Luna dual-use launcher, but they couldn't find the warheads. Luna could be used with conventional weapons or with nuclear weapons. And U.S. military experts looking at these photographs said, well, these are the launchers, but there should be warheads for them. And they were looking for them, but they never discovered the actual bunkers where the warheads were kept. And so they never had evidence that they were there. They absolutely did not know and did not even suspect that the nuclear-armed cruise missiles were there, of which there were 80 with a range reaching southern Florida. Now, if the United States knew about that, I think it probably would have made them much more cautious, because they would have realized that if any military action is taken against the island, especially land invasion, there might be a very real possibility of a nuclear strike. And that's exactly what we know now. The orders were, in the event of paratroopers landing, use tactical nuclear weapons, but not strategic. It probably would have made people more cautious, but maybe the more macho, testosterone-driven people would actually be arguing even stronger for taking these out as soon as possible. I hope not.
Thank you. Let's jump briefly to the end of the crisis. And one of the factors was the taking out of the Jupiter missiles in Turkey. and that was kept secret, as you said. But why did Khrushchev let the United States get away with it? Because by keeping it secret, it made him look much weaker than he really was.
It's a great question, and a lot of people are debating exactly that. From my reading of the events, I think that Khrushchev actually stuck to the deal that they made. And maybe his concern was that if he made that deal public, then the whole non-invasion pledge will be taken back or will be put in question in the United States, especially by Congress. That he actually stuck to the commitment that he made to the Americans, that the deal is that there is no deal, and if he went public, then the U.S. will say, no, there was no deal. I think he just essentially kept his word, although it did make him look weak and target for accusations in October 1964, but even then he never mentioned it. In fact, it was never mentioned in the Soviet Union or here until the late 1980s when Ambassador Dobrynin made it public at one of the conferences by confronting Gerhard Sorensen and said, you are describing this meeting between Robert Kennedy and Dobrynin when they made the deal, but you're not talking about the deal. Why is that? And he admitted he cleaned up the memoirs a little bit.
I'll open it in a minute to the audience. Just one more question about Khrushchev and Kennedy. Khrushchev, as you reported, comes across quite cautious and scared. Okay. What about Kennedy? Do you think he was most dovish, you said, but was his strategy towards the crisis as well-meaning, as constructive, as is often reported in the literature, or do you have a different?
I think what's really important to emphasize here is how their position changed. Khrushchev was not cautious and careful before the crisis. In fact, he was exuberant and showing all kinds of bravado and making statements like, if Americans do anything about it, well, the entire Baltic fleet will come to fight for Cuba. He certainly was not cautious and careful during his meeting with Kennedy in Vienna in 1961, June 1961. The closer it got to the crisis, he got more and more scared and concerned because he was realizing that if the missiles are discovered, the United States will not just swallow it. He cut back on the plans, on deployment plans, quite substantially, really, really substantially, almost cutting off the entire naval deployment. And during the crisis, when Kennedy, after the Kennedy speech, we have the Politburo session, which discusses possible options. You can hear almost that they're scared, and Khrushchev is scared. And he immediately starts to find a way out of the crisis. He's not even bargaining. He's just saying, we'll take missiles out. We'll take missiles out. He's not saying, we'll take a little bit. He says, you said take out offensive weapons, we'll do that. Khrushchev, before October, before the 13 days, is also very macho, and we know now more and more about numerous plots to assassinate Castro, Kennedy's plots, to assassinate Castro. Really reckless policy, because at the time, when the Cuban Missile Crisis was about to happen, there were planned U.S. maneuvers on the island of Vieques with the game plan to invade the island and eliminate a regime of a dictator, and the name of the dictator is Ortsak, which is Castro spelled backwards. But when the crisis hits and Kennedy is spending his days at the EXCOM listening to various options and trying to imagine what happens, what is every next step in the escalation, and he realizes that even with aerial strike, they would not be able to take out all the missiles, and as a result, even one nuclear missile hitting Atlanta, he says, is unacceptable. He grows up, he matures. Same what happens with Rousseau. And he's also willing to compromise very, very deeply and take back his positions. So who was more responsible? It's hard to say. Both, you know, facing the possibility of nuclear war, suddenly became sober and responsible and completely stepped away from the boyish, you know, rattling of the sabers. And they both resolved the crisis in a very responsible way. Of the three, I would say Castro did not have that nuclear learning. Definitely did not rise to the same level of maturity, but he was in kind of different situation. He was first forced to take the missiles, then completely betrayed by the Soviets, expecting an invasion, which would be the final invasion that would destroy his country and his regime, and was trying to keep any kind of protection after the Soviets leave. What is he left with facing the United States? So I think all three, with Castro less of, to a lesser degree, learned a lot from the crisis, and the leaders of two superpowers were able to negotiate in an unprecedented way.
Thanks very much. Let's open it to a question from the audience. Roger Lodgson.
Well, thank you for a very enlightening talk. That was really terrific. But I had a question that speaks to your last comment about the Cubans. You make them out to be the wild card. How much control did they have over any of the nukes? Tactical, inner, whatever?
None. They had no control at any point. Tacticals were controlled exclusively by the Soviets, controlled, serviced. Cubans were not anywhere in the range. But by the initial agreement, the Soviets were going to transfer them to the Cubans over a period of time which would probably take 2 or 3 years while they would train the Cuban personnel to maintain and use them. And that, fortunately, did not happen because the Cubans were not obedient enough, were a little too independent, and the Soviets got the idea that it's not a good idea to have their hands on the nukes. But they never, for one day,
Thank you.
If they had left the nuclear weapons in Cuba, it seems to me, remembering what was going on, that we would have gone ballistic. And I'm wondering, weren't the Russians, you know, didn't they understand the United States well enough to know that that was a very high risk strategy?
That's a great question. Well, you know, experts weren't consulted. And
no historians?
No, they weren't invited. In fact, Mikoyan was against the deployment for exactly that reason. He says, you know, what happened when the Americans discovered, they would never agree to that. And the other person who expressed disagreement later, but for different reasons, he can't really hide them in Cuba, was the Soviet military representative in Cuba, who knew the leadership, who knew the island, and he argued that it's impossible to camouflage them in Cuba. It doesn't have thick forests that, you know, it would be very visible, and they will be discovered. But the General Secretary, the Premier at the time, decided we will put these missiles. His military supported him, and as usual, at the Presidium, everybody voted for it. If they were left in Cuba, like Castro suggested, all their caves here, if the tactical nuclear weapons were left in Cuba, at the time the Americans did not know, but it's inevitable, I think, that very soon they would have discovered them. And that would have provoked a major crisis. Because if the Cubans had even partial or dual control, it's not so much that they would have used them, then they would have legitimate reasons to say they're here because of the agreement. The agreement is completely legal under the international law. You can't do anything with that. Well, you want to try an invasion? Well, that's exactly why they're here, right?
Thank you. So a quick comment and then a question. So you said Kennedy has been portrayed as being very decisive. Actually, there was a frontline program on PBS last year which actually showed exactly what you said, that the generals wanted to invade. He wasn't mm-hmm. sure what to do, but was worried anyway. So he wasn't shown as being very decisive, actually. Mm-hmm. My question is, there are things that are very different. There's not a clear parallel, but the situation in Crimea today, I do see a parallel that I want you to comment on, and that is, the Crimea is near Russia. Everyone views that it's clear Russia views that as something in their backyard that is very important to them. And people are criticizing Obama for being too dovish, but yet it's almost like the position Khrushchev was in. In those days, did he want to go to a possible war for Cuba when it's not really necessary for, you know, from the Soviets' point of view? You know what I mean? In other words, they can let Cuba go away, and it isn't going to affect them, just as we can let the Crimea go away. And the hawks are now saying, well, you've got to be very forceful. So my question is, do you see a parallel that our calculation right now is that Putin is much more likely to escalate to a very serious thing if we do, and so we back off? And Khrushchev said the Americans are much more likely to escalate than we are because they view this as very important to them.
Mm-hmm. In other words, when the leadership of both countries actually look into a probability of what might happen as a result of escalation, they would step back from the brink. In that sense, I think the parallel is legitimate. I think what I would change this parallel a little bit to help understand the Russian concern here, and for the Russians, Crimea, of course, historically has been always part of Russia, but the Russians, both the government and the population, see the NATO expansion as a major threat, and Ukraine was seen as kind of this red line over which NATO should not go. And the concern was that if Ukraine joined or signed the association agreement but eventually joined the European Union, it might, and it wanted to under the Tymoshenko government and Yushchenko government, to join NATO, expressed its preference and asked for the MAP plan. And that creates real fear that you could compare then, you know, if you suddenly have, I don't think it has ever been likely. I don't think we ever got ever close to it. But just, if you want to put yourself in the shoes of the Soviet Russians, say, NATO bases in the Crimea, do you Americans remember how you reacted when we put our missiles next to your shores? Well, that's how we feel about Crimea. But it's a very stretched comparison because, again, I don't think that we ever got anywhere close to Ukraine actually joining NATO. I don't think.
So let me just follow up real quick. So do you think, given that perspective, that Putin will not try to do anything in the other, you know, like Estonia and Latvia? In other words, the threat is gone, so he is not going to risk an escalation by pushing further, which the Estonians today on the radio said they're deathly afraid.
I think he will not. It's, you know, from everything I read and see, I think it's really against his interests to do it. In fact, what he will try to do now is step back and show best behavior because he is interested in economic cooperation with Europe, less so the United States, but also the United States. There are lots of things that are involved. There are military contracts, to modernize, Russia needs to be integrated with European economies in some way. And I think that the signals that we get now from Russia are very cautious signals trying to reassure. I would even say, you know, watching everything going up to the referendum, Putin gave this press conference on March 4th where he said several times, we do not have an intention to incorporate Crimea. We do not have an intention to make Crimea part of Russia. But when the Crimeans already had the referendum, and it was extremely popular both in Crimea and in Russia, even a person who is not the biggest Democrat in the world has his own base, and the base really wanted Crimea back. And he decided that the mango was falling into his arms, hands, and grabbed them.
So the lesson from Cuba would be for both Putin and Obama to de-escalate and to be cautious and maybe even to be scared.
Scared and not use Cold War rhetoric.
Yes, exactly. Mike Morgan.
I've got a question about the Soviet decision-making process that led up to the installation of the missiles in Cuba. You emphasized in your talk the importance of ideology in that Soviet decision-making, the commitment to the socialist cause and Cuba as a socialist country. I wonder if you could comment on the extent to which broader geopolitical considerations figured into or didn't figure into Soviet decision-making. Did the Politburo think at all about the correlation of forces very broadly as they were making this decision? Mm-hmm.
First of all, the best answer to a similar question was given by Sergei Khrushchev. He said, you know, my father was a very simple person. Do you really think that they would do anything like that? They weren't. The decision-making was limited to less than 10 people. The loudest voice, probably the most influential voice, was the military. They did consider the balance of powers, the global balance of powers, the military especially. They realized that, let me give you exact numbers, that at the time, in October 1962, the Soviet Union had 20 ICBMs capable of reaching the United States and 300 warheads, nuclear warheads, total. The United States had 5,000 warheads that were capable of reaching the Soviet Union. Calculations, very simple. But the military were much more aware of that than for sure. So the first, the most important motivation was to protect Cuba, do anything, because they thought the invasion could be any day, do anything to protect Cuba. Second, the balance of power, yes, especially on the military side. Now, in addition to the purely military balance of power, there was an ideological balance of power. And this is really, really important to understand. Within the communist movement at the time, since the death of Stalin, the Chinese were really rising and presenting themselves, positioning themselves as the new leader, the new revolutionary force. They were saying that the Soviets were now conservative and not willing to support the National Liberation Movement, and they were actually compromising with the main enemy, whereas they should be supporting the revolutionary wave. And that mattered for Khrushchev. There was a competition within the socialist camp about who is the leader of the socialist camp in the communist movement. And Cuba was the key. And the Chinese were very, very active in Cuba. And when you look at these conversations that that Mikoyan has with the Cuban leadership, he always mentions China and says, oh, China is not giving up. China, oh, what did the Chinese do? They sent some blood? That's all? Look what we did. So having Cuba as the Soviet closest ally, as this first state in Latin America that's building socialism, military was so strong, was very important for the Soviets. They abandoned Cuba and the Cubans turned to China. That would be a major defeat. And you also mentioned the ideological side. This ideological side was interesting because in Cuba, the Soviets saw something very different. They knew at the time that all these East European socialist countries were socialist because the Soviet troops were there. They were very aware. They were kind of disillusioned with their own system already. They knew the system was not the one that they were trying to build in their revolutionary youth, and they also knew that they only new communist regimes are created by exporting the revolution. And suddenly, in Latin America, they have this popular, genuine revolution, which reminded them of their revolutionary youth, and it was genuine. The Soviets had nothing to do with it, and the population supported it. And they were also young and attractive and charismatic and sang songs. And for those several years, the entire Soviet Union was absolutely in love with Cuba. Just, it was a Cuban love fest. The best poets, singers, performers were sent to Cuba. Evgeny Yevtushenko actually was, during the crisis in Cuba, he was filming a movie which became extremely popular. I just rewatched it last year, called I Am Cuba, Soy Cuba. So there was this infatuation, fascination with Cuba. Mikoyan, when he goes there for the first time, he says to his son, I'm quoting, I began to realize that I have fallen in love with this country, its revolution, its leaders, and its people. Everything here was unlike the Soviet bureaucratic system with its rigid rules and idiotic institutions.
And its secret laws.
Well, he made it up himself. So.
Well, a question about Khrushchev. Did he fall the cause of Cuba largely?
I wouldn't say largely, but Cuba won, probably was one of the five major factors. I think his domestic policy and his economic reform, kind of the thaw efforts, the effort to de-Stalinize eventually post-Cuban.
The humiliation because of the Cuban Missile Crisis that wasn't seen as humiliation.
Well, see,
as much?
In the public mind, there was no humiliation. Only those, you know, 10, 15 people knew what actually happened. The public was told the story that they brought those weapons there, scared the Americans, defended Cuba, made them make the non-invasion pledge, achieve their goal, and nobly withdraw weapons after we accomplished the mission. So publicly, it was not seen as humiliation, but within the presidium, it was.
Thank you. Eugene, what?
No, I'm listening to these other questions.
Okay, I'll ask another question. No, sorry.
I guess I'd like to maybe follow up on this comment. And that is, it seems like today's crisis in Ukraine, this Cuban Missile Crisis, are examples of the loss or the demise of what I thought was a concept of the sphere of influence. In the U.S., we had the Monroe Doctrine, said stay out of the Western Hemisphere, okay? We seem to follow it in Europe after World War II. There were a lot of people that said, you know, we have to free the Eastern European countries, but the U.S. recognized that the Soviet Union, you know, was in control, and it wasn't worth spending our blood, sweat, and tears on that. But lately, it seems like, you know, with Cuba, now with the Ukraine and the move of NATO into Eastern Europe, the sphere of influence concept no longer exists. Do you have any comments on that? Did it ever exist?
I think clearly it did exist and was, the leaders, I think, were very aware of it in 19th century, 20th century, during the Cold War especially. Spheres of influence were very visible, and even though they were not designated anywhere in the public document, like you said, the United States knew that as much as we want to liberate the Eastern European countries, we tacitly accept that this is their sphere of influence, and this is ours. And, you know, Stalin and Churchill negotiated directly about spheres of influence and how the country would be divided. But there was a moment in international relations called the end of the Cold War where people wrote about the end of history. And then, if it's the end of history, the victory of the liberal ideal, then spheres of influence don't apply anymore. Because instead of balance of power or balance of interest, there are universal norms on the basis of which new international relations will be structured. And the person who first said it and promoted very actively was the Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev, who said, Eastern Europe, you can go, because we don't feel threatened by the United States anymore. Well, right now, he is probably the most unpopular person, number two. Well, he is now Yeltsin's rival for number one. Okay? He's not respected, to say it very mildly, in the Soviet Union, because he gave away the Soviet sphere of influence. I think what's happening now is that they're actually coming back. And Putin is very vocal about it. And he is saying, United States, you of all the people should know exactly what it is. Who said modern doctrine? You need to understand that this is our sphere of influence. And we want to cooperate, but you cannot increase your presence, especially military presence, in our sphere of influence, which he defines as the former Soviet space minus the Baltics.
Can you switch that on?
Sure, is it, did it go off?
Something happened.
When he hit the floor.
You were talking about how the CIA, their estimates were very low compared to what was really going on in Cuba. So my question is, well, were there any repercussions? Supposedly during that time, the CIA was considered the best throughout its history. So mm-hmm. Can you comment on anything like that? What happened with the CIA? Did they all of a sudden say, you know, we got to put more resources into the Soviet Union in Cuba, et cetera, et cetera? Or they just blow it off?
You know, I am not fully qualified to answer your question. There definitely was a discussion and analysis of the failure to detect all the, you know, both the combat troops and the tactical nuclear weapons within the CIA. I simply do not know enough what conclusions were made. Now, maybe Tom can, you know,
do I come in?
I think afterwards they began to figure out that nukes were there. When the Soviet ships were coming home, some of the radiation detectors, some of their tracking, and then the photo interpreters went back to the film and actually reconstructed after the fact the path of warheads and discovered by February that
63,
so 5 months later, that, wow, there were warheads there. And because we tracked them out, McNamara could give a press conference saying, we know they're all out.
And well, he was right. They were.
The strategic and the tactical were both out. He didn't know about the tactical. He still didn't know about the tactical. He found out about the tactical in 1992 in Havana. Svetlana was there.
To just tell you a funny, really funny personal story. So in 1992, I'm a fresh graduate student at Emory, working on the Cuban Missile Crisis, and I was asked to help the Brown University organize the Soviet delegation. So it's late 1991, the Soviet delegation to Cuba. I went back to Moscow, I interviewed them, I, you know, helped them get their visas. Early January 1992, they come to Cuba, suddenly discovering that they're no longer a Soviet military delegation, they're a Russian military delegation. They were mad, and they were gonna, you know, say it as it was, and they presented evidence that tactical nuclear weapons were there. But to make their story a little more impressive, they also said, and the local commanders had full authority to use them on their own.
That wasn't known until then?
No, it wasn't known. But it was not true that they had authority. They had capability, not authority. So I'm sitting there with the American delegation next to McNamara, and I think one person away from me, because I was asked to check translation on most sensitive passages. And I, you know, translation was good. So I'm sitting here, and General Gripkov, the planner of Operation Anavir, of the Cuban deployment, he he takes this document and starts reading these numbers that I just gave you of the tactical nuclear weapons and says that local commanders had the authority to use it. And then the mayor looks up, looks left, looks right, and he's just so shocked and he's trying to listen. And he motions to me and he says, check the translation, check the translation. Did he just say that? I said, yes, he just said that because I heard it in Russian. And McNamara, I don't think he directly interrupted him, but he interjected. He said, General Grybko, did you just say that I just hear that tactical nuclear weapons were in Cuba during the crisis? Could you repeat that? And Grybkov was offended because for him it meant that McNamara challenged his words. And he looks at him and he says, what, do you want me to sign an affidavit? And stopped and did not respond during the break. McNamara asks me to come with him and he says, let's go talk to Grybkov, you know him, right? Okay, we go. I knew it would not end well. We go to Grybkov, get him in the hallway. So McNamara asks this long question. McNamara asks this long question about how many were there. Are you sure? What was the authority? Do you know what it would have led to? So the question lasts about 5 minutes. I'm translating. Grybkov listens very attentively, like intently looking at us. And he gets madder and madder as the question goes on. And when I finish translating the question, he literally turns around and leaves. Because, again, for him, it was that this American Minister of Defense is doubting his words, the person who planned the operation. And then, of course, it was confirmed because not only Grybkov said that, he broke the original documents. And since then, we know the story.
Thank you very much. This is all most interesting. Let me just ask you another question about JFK. I think the lesson was both Khrushchev and JFK concluded that in the course of the crisis they had to be much more cautious than initially. Would you say that initially Kennedy would have had a different procedure to approach the crisis, for example? Was it necessary for him to go public, or could he have tried to develop the whole interchange with the Soviet Union via back channels in secret, or was it really impossible for him, maybe in view of journalistic leaks and so on?
Well, that is actually the position that Soviet Ambassador Dobrynin had. He said it was absolutely unnecessary to go public. In fact, by going public, he increased the danger of the crisis. He increased the danger of escalation. He said that there was a very well-functioning back channel. They were negotiating quietly. They had very good interaction with the administration. And that these issues, if they were raised in the back channel with Dobrynin, would have been easier to resolve. However, because at the moment Dobrynin is not informed at all, the operation was so secret that the Soviet ambassador in Washington had no idea about it. He learned it from Kennedy's speech. So that would have created a problem. Say Kennedy decided to go through the back channel, goes to the Dobrynin and says, you put nuclear missiles on Cuba. And the Dobrynin would say, absolutely not. And Kennedy's emissaries would say, well, you're lying to us. Like,
but Kennedy didn't know that Dobrynin didn't know.
Exactly.
So
the answer to your question, in my view, it would have been a much better way to do it, except for the fact that he went to the Russian.
But isn't the counter-argument, if I may interrupt, isn't the counter-argument that apparently, on the part of the United States, there were about to come out media reports and media leaks which would have revealed there were missiles on Cuba and the whole crisis would have blown up, so that Kennedy felt kind of forced to go public, as it would have become public anyway? Is that not a justified counterargument?
I guess it depends on the time period. There were no leaks between the 16th and the 22nd, and that period of time might have been enough to start the discussion. Now, whether it would be enough to persuade the Soviets, I don't know. it seems like the element of possible escalation had a pacifying, cooling effect on both sides. But the fact itself of going public and provoking this immediate crisis in the Soviet Union, in the leadership, and in Cuba. In Cuba, everybody knew about it. And in the Soviet Union, nobody knew about it until mainly in Cuba.
Thank you very much. We have got one final question. Marek, please.
Sorry, I don't want to keep people, but I'm wondering about the Soviet decision to put the missiles in Cuba. And the Soviets may have felt that it was legal because of the U.S. missiles in Turkey, but they obviously thought that there'd be a reaction from the United States because they insisted on doing it in secret.
Mm-hmm.
So do we know anything about how they planned to reveal what they had done?
Mm-hmm.
And did they anticipate an antagonistic American reaction? And what do we know what they thought the Americans might do and how they might respond to whatever the Americans might do?
We know the general answer. We don't know the details of discussions because the discussions were just not recorded.
Mm-hmm.
You are absolutely right. Contrary to Khrushchev's bravado, we're doing everything legally, they can't object. The reason they decided to do it secretly was that they were afraid of the U.S. reaction. The plan was we put everything there secretly, and the deployment original was planned to be much bigger than those 42,000. If you're interested, I can talk a little more about specifics. But so we would put everything in Cuba secretly, and then in November there was a scheduled plenum of the Central Committee of the Communist Party, closely coinciding with midterm elections. In fact, the elections, and again, we have very little evidence, but there is evidence that the Soviets were concerned about the elections and they didn't want the hawks to win. And if the missiles were discovered, then you know, one of the reasons, one of the outcomes could be that the more hawkish anti-Soviet elements would be strengthened in Congress. So they would do it as a fait accompli after the elections in a great speech by Khrushchev at the plenum. But, and they were successful, but not entirely successful, because already in September there are reports from Cuba that the Soviets are moving a lot of weaponry, not yet about the nuclear missiles. And the United States saw a lot of movement of the ships, but the ships were civilian. That's how they missed it. The ships were all civilian. And Khrushchev over this period of time in September is very concerned, if not to say scared. And he cuts back the deployment, thinking, well, we probably would not be able to do it completely in secret. Calculation was, if you already deployed everything you wanted, and you had a signed military agreement with Cuba, you announce this agreement at the plenum, and say, according to this agreement, we deployed the following forces in Cuba. And then it would be very difficult for the United States to argue against it, or that was the Soviet calculation, because they themselves had very similar military agreements with countries like Turkey, which had nuclear missiles.
Thank you very much indeed. This was a most fascinating and enlightening talk. Thanks very much. Svetlana, I hope you will come back to us with some new revelations, which undoubtedly will come out. I think the main lesson we have drawn from your talk today is clearly that historians need to be consulted. If historians had been there, either in the Kremlin or in D.C., then perhaps the crisis would have taken a very different, much more cautious procedure than it did. This leads me to announcing the next talk and the final talk of the semester, which is on April the 15th, when George Herrick of the University of Kentucky will join us. And exceptionally, he will not talk about the Vietnam War, though that is, of course, one of his great specialties. He will talk about America's foreign policy perspectives.
So what is the grand strategy, and is there a grand strategy for American foreign policy in the 21st century? And he will talk about this on the basis of the strategy and the foreign policy making in the United States on the basis of the 19th and 20th century. So it's very much a historical approach to grand strategy in the 21st century. George Herring on the 15th of April. You're very welcome, all of you, to come back and join us. And for tonight, I would like to thank Svetlana again. Thanks.
Can I just say one final thing I forgot? If you want to know everything about the Cuban, it's here. This is an absolutely unprecedented, incredible publication by our colleague and friend, Jim Hirschberg, who put together documents from how many countries I can't even count on the Cuban Missile Crisis. This is the first truly international history of the missile crisis, and it's full of revelations. It's just how many pages full of revelations? 807 pages of revelations, if you want to know everything.
And it's free.
It's here. I think so, yeah.
It is free of charge. You can get it from the Cold War International History Project at the Wilson Center, so just drop them an email. And all these 800 or 900 pages will be in the mail
and
to you.
And they are on PDF, in PDF on their website too.
So exactly. And you would see what we please if you printed out all of it. Well, thanks very much again. Thanks, Svetlana, for coming to join us.
Thank you so much,
especially
for the weather. I am so pleased. You couldn't have done better.
Thank you.